So, last class we have been talking about how to find out the intensity. What is this intensity of the XRD pattern for any peak in the XRD pattern is related to? We said that intensity comes from a relation like this, where intensity is considered as square of what is called structure factor. Structure factor is nothing but the amplitude of the scattering that is taking place from a unit cell. If there is a unit cell, every crystal has a unit cell, and this unit cell has certain atoms inside, and these atoms have certain electrons inside them. So these electrons inside the atoms are the ones which are actually scattering, and all these scattered beams are all coming and getting amplified by, because they all join together and then come out as one single beam from a particular HKL plane. So whenever you have HKL plane which is giving the actual diffraction, this diffracted beam is coming because this X-ray is interacting with the atoms inside the HKL plane, and these atoms have electrons inside them. It is these electrons which are actually interacting with the X-ray and finally giving out a diffracted beam. So as a result, the structure factor is nothing but the amplitude of the diffracted beam coming out of the scattering from a unit cell, and this structure factor is given by an expression which is called F into e power 2 pi I into Hx plus Ky plus Lz. This is a very, very profound equation which has been derived by looking at the whole diffraction principles, and we will not go into the derivation of it, but take this and try to understand what does this tell us in terms of intensity. So here this F is the structure factor. I have already explained structure factor is nothing but the amplitude of the diffracted beam that is coming out of a unit cell, and where this unit cell is composed of two things. One, it has this structure factor has a small F in this. This small F is what we call it as atomic scattering factor. That means it is nothing but the amplitude of scattering that is taking place from one atom. Each atom has certain electrons inside it, right? So the electrons inside this atom are giving a scattering. So this particular scattering that is taking place from one atom is given as F, and obviously that depends on the atomic number. Okay, scattering factor is taken almost proportional to, and in a number of cases it is taken as equivalent to Z. Why Z? Because as the atomic number increases, the number of electrons increase. Because atomic number is nothing but representing the number of electrons. If the number of electrons is increasing, the amount of scattering of the X-ray beam is increasing. It is because it is these electrons which are scattering the X-ray. So as a result, as Z increases, F increases. Okay? So F also is found to be a function of theta, and in fact people have found that small f can be written as a function of sine theta by lambda, and they saw that there is a relation like this. As the theta increases, the f decreases. Because what does it mean? That means if I have a plane and I have two beams falling on this, if this has a lower theta, this has a higher theta, okay, and a beam which is falling at a higher theta will try to penetrate through, okay, and as a result the diffracted beam that is coming out will have lower intensity. Okay, so because we are concerned about what is the beam that is coming out, the intensity of that beam that is coming out, so whenever the beam has a higher angle, such a higher angle beam tries to have more penetration, a glancing angle will not have a chance to penetrate and it just comes out. So as the angle is smaller, sin theta is smaller, then the intensity, what is F? F is nothing but the scattering that is taking place from one single atom. And that scattering that is taking place from one single atom will be the highest when theta is 0. Whenever theta is 0 or sin theta is 0, you will see that that is a thing. It is also seen that it is also a function of lambda. For example, when lambda is very large or when lambda is very small. As the lambda is small, this you will see that the beam has more energy. When beam has more energy, this beam goes through and penetrates through and as a result gets absorbed inside the material rather than coming out. As a result, whenever lambda is small, you will see the F will be small. As lambda is small, sin theta by lambda is large and the F is smaller. So if you want to have high atomic scattering factor, you should prefer to use a larger lambda. But lambda is not in our hand to a large extent, because lambda is fixed. I am using copper K alpha for my work. So the lambda is fixed. So we don't bother much about lambda, but this gives you an idea generally that whenever I have an XRD pattern, the higher angle peaks always will have smaller intensities when compared to lower angle peaks. This is the reason why you always see a higher angle peaks are always smaller. For example, in a FCC material, let's say aluminum, the 111 peak is always the biggest. Whereas if I go to 220, 220 will be very small. So that happens because of this. The larger the angle, the more the penetration, the smaller will be the intensity of the beam that is coming out. So this is what is called atomic scattering factor. And this factor that you are seeing, the structure factor has two parts. One part is the atomic scattering factor. That means scattering taking place from one atom. And the unit cell is not one single atom. Unit cell is composed of a number of atoms. So as a result, this particular thing is talking about the whole unit cell. If I multiply this factor with this, it tells me the total diffraction that is happening from the unit cell, where x, y, z are nothing but the positions of these atoms, and HKL is for a particular HKL plane. So if I want to know what is the diffraction that is taking place from a particular HKL plane, what is the intensity of this beam that is coming out, I need to know what material it is, because F depends on that material. I need to know what HKL it is. I also need to know where are the atoms sitting inside the unit cell. All these three will decide this I. It will be decided by F. It will be decided by HKL. It will also be decided by XYZ. And let us look at how XYZ decide this. Let us rewrite this formula once again and do this for two cases. One is an FCC case, another is a BCC case for the sake of understanding. Let's write it. F equal to small f into e power 2 pi I into hx plus ky plus lz. This is our formula. And where F is atomic scattering factor and 2 pi I, we know it's basically imaginary I there. And where x, y, z are the atomic positions. Now, if I am taking a BCC, BCC has mostly two lattice points per unit cell. Right? We have defined it in the previous class. Where are the positions of these two lattice points? If I now redraw the BCC unit cell for you, it has lattice points at all the 8 corners. And it has a lattice point inside. And I said this lattice point can be one single atom or a number of atoms. Let us say I am talking about pure iron, let us say. Then it is only iron atoms at each of these corners and the body center. What are the positions of this? I define all the corners. You know that all the corners put together is giving only one atom. One lattice point per unit cell. Right? And the body center is another, which is another. So, all this put together should be represented by one lattice point, and that is taken as usually 0, 0, 0. So, 0, 0, 0 is this for us. But all of them can be treated as 0, 0, 0 because it is all of them contributing to only one lattice point. So, I take that one of the coordinates for one atom, this is the coordinate. For the second atom, I say the coordinates are half, half, half because it is at the center of the body. So there are two atoms inside the iron unit cell. One is at 0, 0, 0, another is at half, half, half. So as a result, in this XYZ, there are two positions. So if there are two positions, I can write this as the scattering taking place from this atom, scattering taking place from this atom, both of them have to be added up to know the total scattering happening from the whole unit cell, because the unit cell has two atoms. So if that can be written as F of e power 2 pi I into 0, if I put this whole thing becomes zero, because h of h into 0, k into 0, y, l into 0, okay, plus again f of e power 2 pi I into h k y, x is half, y is half, z is half. So half into h plus k plus l. So this can be written as f into e power 2 pi I into 0 plus f into e power 2 pi I, 2 pi I call it as pi I now, because this 2 and 2 gets cancelled, into h plus k plus l. Now this here, I need to know certain property of this e power 2 pi I. We say e power n pi I is equal to 1 if n is even. If e power n pi I is minus 1 if n is odd. This is the relation that we know from mathematics, that the relation for e power n pi I. Now if that is the case, now this 0 is taken as even always. So as a result, this value is 1. This is, that means this is f into 1. Now take this. If this h plus k plus l, if h plus k plus l is even, then this whole thing is equal to 1, because it becomes e power n pi I, where n equal to even. If this whole thing is taken as n for me, okay, if this whole thing is even, then this e power h plus k plus l into pi I will be equal to 1. If h plus k plus l is odd, then this whole thing becomes minus 1. Right? So that means this can become plus f or minus f, depending on if h plus k plus l is even or h plus k plus l is odd. This can be either minus f or plus f. If it is plus f, my structure factor is equal to 2f. If it is minus f, my structure factor equal to 0. Right? F minus f is 0. So that means my intensity, I just now said intensity is square of structure factor. So intensity will be equal to 4f square, or intensity will be equal to 0, depending on whether h plus k plus l is even or h plus k plus l is odd. So if my h plus k plus l is even, then I get certain intensity which is proportional to 4f square. And if h plus k plus l is odd, I get 0 intensity. That means all the peaks, all the HKLs whose h plus k plus l is odd will not have any intensity in a BCC diffraction pattern. So if I have a sample, which is a BCC sample, and if an X-ray beam is falling on it, and if diffracted beams are coming out of it, which are all collected by our goniometer, and if you are putting them in the form of I versus theta or I versus 2 theta, you will see that here you get only peaks which correspond to h plus k plus l to be even. All these peaks will have only, whenever h plus k plus l is odd, the intensity will be 0. All those will not have any intensity at all. So you will see that only certain peaks will appear, certain peaks will not appear. So if I look at HKL and start putting what are all the possibilities, I can see that if I put HKL, for example, 100 is the first lowest possible index plane that I can think of. 100, if I add all of them, then I get h plus k plus l equal to odd. 1 plus 0 plus 0 is 1. So that means this peak will not appear in the BCC at all. You will not see 100 peak. But the next one is 110. You will see this, because this addition will make it as even. Then if I go to the 111, you will not see this again, because 1 plus 1 plus 1 is odd. So if it is odd, f equal to 0. If f equal to 0, I equal to 0. So the next one is 200. Then this is present. Then if I put the next one 210, I am simply increasing the numbers. Okay? So 210 again is not present, because it is, sum is odd. So if I look at it, the only peaks that come out for a BCC are the 110, 200, and 211, 220, and 310, and so on and so forth. You can get any numbers. The next question is, how many numbers I will get? How many peaks I will get? To know that, how many peaks I will get, okay, if you have to see this equation. What is the maximum value of sin theta? 90. Maximum value of theta is 90. Maximum value of sin theta is 1. Okay. So, if I put maximum value of sin theta as 1, then I can say the maximum d equal to lambda by 2 sin theta. Right? This is our formula. So, if sin theta, if I take it as 1, the minimum d is lambda by 2. Up to lambda by 2 is what I can get. I will not get a d whose value is greater than, is less than lambda by 2. This is the d minimum. If this is maximum, this is minimum. D and theta are inversely proportional. So, if this is maximum, then this is minimum. So, the smallest d is always lambda by 2. I will never, so if I want to get smaller d's, and I know you have already seen that d of, for example, d of 100, d of 200, d of 220, we have seen all of them. We saw that as the HKL increase, the d decreases. If you want to get more and more HKL diffraction patterns, that means you should be able to get smaller and smaller d's. Then for that, what you need is a smaller lambda. If you are fixing your copper K alpha, let's say copper K alpha is 1.54. So that means 1.54 by 2 is the smallest d for a given material. If my material is fixed, let's say my material is aluminium, I will not get any peak of aluminium whose d is smaller than this, which is equivalent to 0.77. This will be the smallest. That may be 2 peaks, that may be 3 peaks, or whatever it is. I will not be able to get any peak smaller than this d, because that is what my relation tells me. So, if I want to get more number of peaks, because certain cases, unless I have more number of peaks, I am going to come to it after a little while and tell you that unless you have a large number of peaks, determining the crystal structure becomes very difficult. If you want to get a large number of peaks, what should I do? I choose A lambda, which is smaller. For example, if I use instead of copper K alpha, I use molybdenum K alpha. Copper K alpha is 1.54. Molybdenum K alpha is 0.7. By going to molybdenum K alpha, I am able to lower my D. That means I can get more number of peaks, okay, which are such that up to 0.35. If my lambda is 0.7, up to 0.35 I will get, whatever may be those peaks. So, for each of these, as I can see, that for example, if this is my BCC, for 110, there is a certain D. For 1200, there is a certain D. If I know the A, I can find out the D. D of 110, D of 200, D of 211, D of 220, I can find out all of them. And if wherever this particular D value goes below this particular number, there will be a cutoff. You will only get these many peaks, you will not get this peak at all. So, if I can lower my D, lower my lambda, I may be able to get this, and I also may be able to get this, because now this D is still larger than this 0.35. So, all those D's which are larger than this lambda by 2 alone will be present. All those D's which are smaller than lambda by 2 will not be present. So, only those peaks, if I now do XRD, sometimes you may get only 2 peaks. Sometimes you may get 5 peaks, sometimes you may get 10 peaks. What does that depend on? That depends on two things. One, my A. Why? Because D is A by square root A square plus K square plus L square. So, A is 1. So if I want to get more number of peaks, what should I do? I should have, when will I get more number of peaks with respect to A? I said, if you want, because D depends on A, D also depends on lambda. Because you can see D minimum, I just now defined as lambda by 2. Okay, D depends on A and lambda. D is a function of A and lambda. Because you can see, D depends on theta, okay, and D depends on A, because this is the formula, and D theta depends on lambda. So D depends on lambda. So if you want to get more number of peaks, there are two ways. One is lower the lambda, use smaller lambda. Second is if your A is larger, you get more and more number of peaks. Because if A is larger, D is larger. For example, if I am comparing let's say 2 to 0 peak, D of 2 to 0 of aluminium, D of 2 to 0 of platinum will be different. Why? Because the lattice parameter of platinum and lattice parameter of aluminium are different. So it is possible that if the lattice parameter, if A of platinum is larger than A of aluminium, then D of 2 to 0 for platinum is larger than D of 2 to 0 for aluminium. So as a result, I may be able to see this D, I may not be able to see this D, because this D, if it is smaller than my lambda by 2, this D will not be present. Whereas this D, because it is larger than this, this particular D, it is possible that this D is larger than lambda by 2. So as a result, you will see that the for a platinum sample, you may get a 2 to 0 in your XRD pattern where copper K alpha you are using. For an aluminum, you may not be able to see 2 to 0. So whether you will see a particular peak or not depends only on two factors, lambda and A. The smaller the lambda, the better. The larger the A, that is better. But the A is not in my hand. A is fixed by the crystal structure. So for a given material, okay, I cannot change A. A is given by the material property. So as a result, for a given material, the only way to get more number of peaks is to go to a smaller lambda. Okay, because material property I cannot change, but I can change lambda. Lambda is in my hand, I can simply change the target. Instead of putting a copper target, I can put a chromium, smaller means lambda. The smaller lambda means molybdenum, vanadium, things like that will have smaller. How do I know that? You remember we said earlier that this relation, if you remember, we said that the K alpha, lambda of K alpha decreases as Z increases. This is what this tells you. The frequency increases with Z as Z increases. That means lambda decreases as Z increases. So that means if I choose two materials, let's say copper, and let's say something like a very high atomic number, platinum. If I can have a platinum K alpha will definitely have smaller lambda because its Z is larger. So instead of using a copper K alpha, let me use a platinum K alpha. Like that, if I can choose materials which have molybdenum, for example, molybdenum has higher atomic number. So that's why molybdenum K alpha is much smaller. So I can use a smaller lambda. So whenever you want to, and you will know very soon, why do I need more number of peaks? Very soon. Now let's look at, so what did we understand now? We understood one factor, that you will not see all HKL peaks in a XRD pattern. You will only see some of them. And those are fixed by a particular condition. For BCC, that condition is H plus K plus L should be even. If they are odd, you will not see those peaks at all. Now let's do the same thing for the FCC, which is another popular crystal structure. And if I do that for FCC, and again do the same formula, F equal to small f into e power 2 pi I into Hx plus Ky plus Lz. Now come to FCC. In an FCC, we have 4 lattice points, 4 atomic positions. If I take aluminium, you know that it has atoms at the corners. It has also atoms at the face centers. Right? And atoms at the corners can be represented by 0, 0, 0. Atoms at the face centers, there are 6 face centers. But each face center is contributing only half. So this face center and this face center are parallel to each other. I represent by the same position. So I give 3, half, half, 0, 0, half, 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 0, half. These are the 3 positions. For example, this position, if I want to look at it, this is nothing but half in this x-axis, half in the y axis. This is half of 0 because in the z axis I am not going. So this position I can call it as half of 0, and this is actually half of similarly, if my origin is shifted here, this is also half of 0 depending on how I look at it. So this and this are half of 0. Similarly, I can give something for this. Similarly, I can give something for this. So these are the 4 positions. This is one position, this is one, this is one, this is one. So 4 atoms, 4 positions. If I plug these things into this equation, you will see a situation like this. F equal to F into e power 2 pi I into, first I will put 0, then you get this as 0. Second, F into e power 2 pi I into, one of them is 0. Okay, half of 0, if I take half, half 0. So that means H plus K, L will go to 0. So it will be this pi I only will remain because that half will get cancelled here. Pi I into H plus K you will get, because H plus K by 2, half, half, and the 2 goes off with this 2. So it will be pi I into H plus 2. Another is F of e power pi I into K plus L plus F of e power pi I into L plus Z, L plus H. This is what, in every case there will be a 2 that comes out in the denominator and that 2 gets cancelled with this 2. So you will get this. If I put it as half of 0, this will go to 0. If I put it as 0 half half, this will go to 0. If I put half 0 half, K will go to 0. So in all these 3 cases, in one case you will go not see L, in one case you will not see H, in one case you will not see K. So you will see, and you have 4 positions, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if you look at the whole thing, you will see that this whole thing, for it to be able to see a positive value, this value is always 0. So this is just simply F. And you will see that from this condition, we will see if H, K, L are all even or all odd, then what happens? Then if this is H is even, K is even and L is even, or H is odd, K is odd and L is odd, then you see that this plus this is always even. For example, if this is even and this is even, this plus summation is even. If this is odd, then also summation is even. If this summation is even, then this value will be F, because this will be plus 1, e power n pi I is equal to plus 1 if this n is even. This similarly here also, if K is even and L is even, or if K is odd and L is odd, this is also even. So this is also plus F, this is also plus F. Then what is happening? F equal to 4F. Then that means I equal to 16F square. You can see one interesting thing, that in case of BCC, we saw F equal to 4F square. In case of, this is for BCC. In case of the FCC, we saw it is 16F square. What does that mean? It means that if I have one metal which is BCC, another metal which is FCC, the intensity of the beam is larger for FCC, smaller for BCC. Why is that? Because the number of atoms are more. If the number of atoms are more, more scattering. So FCC metals will always give you higher intense peaks. If I have a mixture of a BCC metal and FCC metal and I put a mixture, send an X-ray beam, and you will see the BCC peaks will be smaller, FCC peaks will be larger. And because of this. And now you can see what happens if they are, if H, K, L are, this is called unmixed. That means they are either all even or all odd. If they are mixed, that means some are even, some are odd. If I take H as even and K and L are odd, just for the sake of example, let's take H as even. This is even. K is odd and L is odd. If K is odd, what is going to happen? This F, if I am putting, the first one is anyway, this is 0. So this is e power n pi I equal to 1. So this is F. This is the first one. Second one, H is even, K is odd. So this is odd. Even plus odd is odd. So if even plus odd is odd, then this is odd. N is odd. If n is odd, you get minus f, right? Similarly here, k is odd and k is odd and l is also odd. If k is odd and l is odd, the summation is even. If the summation is even, it is n is even. If n is even, then you see plus f. This will be 1. 1 into f is f. Similarly, you come here, l is odd and h is even. So, l is odd, h is even. So, this whole summation is odd. So, if the summation is odd, n is odd. If n is odd, this is minus 1, this is minus f. So, you can see that this is 0. 2 plus f's, 2 minus f's cancel. So, intensity is 0. So, whenever the HKL are mixed, that means they are, some of them are even, some of them are odd, you will never get any diffraction pattern. You will see that the diffraction pattern will not have any intensity for such HKL peaks. So, now if I plot, so you can see here that the condition for seeing a peak for FCC is HKL should be unmixed. For BCC, it is H plus K plus L should be even. So, you see two different conditions. So, if I put FCC and BCC and start looking at various peaks 100, 110 and 111 and 200, 210 and 211 and 220 and you may ask me, why are you actually putting in a particular order? To understand this, let's look at this equation. Lambda equal to 2d sin theta, right? So, sin theta is equal to lambda by 2d, right? So, I can write this as d is a by square root a square plus k square plus l square. So, if I square this whole stuff, I can see that sin square theta is equal to lambda square by 4d square, right? So, d is a by square root a square plus k square plus l square. So, if I take a square of this, d square is a square by h square plus k square plus l square. So, if I put d square in the place of d square, this particular formula, I can write this as a square into h square plus k square plus l square, right? So, sin square theta is some constant. Why do I say constant? For a given material, if I am using an aluminium, A is fixed and lambda is already fixed because I am using copper K alpha. So, lambda is fixed, A is fixed. So, this whole thing is fixed. So, sin square theta is always proportional to h square plus k square plus l square. That is the reason why the smallest HKL will have the smallest theta. So, the first peak that you see with with increasing 2 theta, if I put, the first peak will always be the one with the smallest HKL. Whatever is allowed according to this condition. Now, if I look at what are allowed according to this condition, I see in case of BCC, this is allowed. 110 is allowed. But 100 is not allowed. Why? Because H plus K plus L is odd there. Here, 100 is not allowed. 110 is also not allowed. Right? Why it is not allowed? Because 100 is, one is odd, other are mixed, even. This is two are odd, one is even. But here all are even. All are odd. All are odd means this is there. So, this is there. Whereas here, this is not there. 110, 111, you will not see in BCC. Why 111 you don't see? Because if I add all of them, I am getting odd. So, similarly 200, you will see in both of them. Because they are satisfying both the conditions. 200 means H plus K plus L is even. 200 means all are even because 0 is always even for us. So, 200 will be there in both BCC and FCC. And 210 is odd, you get odd, so this is not there. Okay, this is also not there. And 211, if I look at it, if I add all of them, I get even. So, here it is there. Where here it is not there. And why this order? If I take the squares of all these, okay, h square plus k square plus l square, look at it. H square plus k square plus l square is 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, 4 here, 5 here, 6 here. Alright? Look at it. 1 square plus 0 square plus 0 square. 1 square plus 1 square plus 0 square. 1 square plus 1 square plus 1 square. 2 square plus 0 square plus 0 square, 4. 2 square plus 1 square is 5. 2 square plus 1 square plus 1 square, 6. And then 2 square plus 2 square plus 0. This is 8. You do not have something called 7. You do not have h square plus k square plus l square equal to 7, because there cannot be any integers whose squares, if you add, you get a 7. Okay? So the next one is, if increase in the order, I should see 3, 9 let us say, which is 300, which is 9. And 300 again will be unmixed, because one is odd, another is even, and when I add all of them, it is again odd, so this is also not there. Like this, I can find out from each of them what is there, what is not there. And if I do this, I will see that in case of FCC, what are present. If I forget about this, I will only put what are present, possible. 111, 200, 220, and 311, okay, and then 222, and this is how you will see. And if I take the squares, this is 3, h square plus k square plus l square, 4, and this is 8, this is 11, this is 12, and you will see the next one is 331. Yeah, 331 is how much? 19, but there is a 16 also in the middle. Okay, that is 400. Then you have 331, which is 19, and then 420, so 16 plus 4, it is 20. So these are the first, let us say, 7 or 8 peaks that you see in a FCC. You will not see other peaks. Whereas, if I see here, you will see that the 110, 200, 211, 220, and then 310, okay, and then you will see then this is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 and 12, which comes as 222. These are all h square plus k square plus l square. Squares of all these. Summation of squares of all these. So 3 square plus 1 square is 10. 2 square plus 2 square plus 2 square is 12. So you can see the next one will be 14. 14 means it will be 3 square plus 2 square plus 1 square. 14. 9 plus 4 plus 1, 14, and then 16, 400. If you carefully look at it, you see this is going in a very even fashion. This, so that's why the distances between these peaks in a BCC are all even. They, you will always see that they are evenly spaced, because the distance, the difference between these is always the same. The difference between this and this is 2. Difference between this and this is 2. Difference between this and this is 2. As a result, the sine square theta difference is also 2. Okay? So, as a result, we will be able to see that you can easily recognize this very easily. Because the moment we call this as fingerprint pattern, the moment you see a BCC pattern, you can say it is BCC just by looking at the peaks without doing any calculation. Just look at whether they are all equally spaced. If they are equally spaced, it is BCC. If they are too close by and too close by and too close by and with one separated, that is a typical of FCC. You can see this is 3, 4, 11, 12, 19, 20. Between that there will be 1, 1. So you will see a pattern where you will see two peaks very close by, one peak, again two peaks close by, again one peak, again two peaks close by. This is a typical FCC pattern. If you have to only differentiate between these two, you can differentiate like this. Then now, how do we actually find out the crystal structure? So what we do is this. What we do is this. I know this aspect now. The BCC is this. Now, if I say I have some pattern, okay? I will only tell you how to find out from this pattern whether this is BCC or FCC. First, let us do that, because this is easy to do. So how do I do this? To do this, I know that sine square theta is lambda square by 4 into a square into h square plus k square plus l square. Just now we have written this formula, right? So I know that sine square theta is related to this. So I take the first peak and the second peak. Find out the sine square theta for the first one. and find out the sine square theta for the second one. So sine square theta, sine square 2 theta is some constant which I call it as k, because this value is not going to depend on HKL. This is one HKL, we call it as H1 K1 L1, this is H2 K2 L2 and this is H3 K3 L3. The HKL will not influence this. This is only a constant. So some constant into H2 square plus K2 square plus L2 square. Similarly, sin square 1 theta is K into H1 square plus K1 square plus L1 square. If I take the ratio of these two, so I will see that sin square theta 2 by sin square 1 theta is equal to so H2 square plus K2 square plus L2 square by H1 square plus K1 square plus L1 square. That means what I need to do? I need to simply take the diffraction pattern. I take a sample, put an X-ray beam, get a diffraction pattern something like this. Nothing else to do. Once I get the pattern, I know the theta. Theta can be measured. Once I measure the theta, from the theta, find out the sin square theta. And take the ratio of the second peak and the first peak. Once I take the ratio of the second peak and first peak, second peak to first peak ratio should be related to this. If this ratio turns out to be, if I now go back to FCC, I know that for FCC, second peak by first peak is 4 by 3. Because sin square, the h square plus k square plus l square for the second peak is 2, is 4. H square plus k square plus l square for the first peak is 3. If this ratio is equal to 4 by 3, then I say this is FCC. Just look at the second peak and the first peak, that's it. And if the ratio turns out to be 2, then I say it is BCC. I cannot say it is BCC, hold on for a while. We will say it is BCC after a while. First thing is, first of all, if it is not 4 by 3, it is not FCC at all. So, we will continue this and find out the other crystal structures within in the next class, and we will hold on for the time being and see how the structure can be determined for the other crystal structures as we go along. Thank you.